So anyway, hey, welcome to the first one ever, animation hour or less. And so I'm trying to think of what could I possibly do? And I don't know, I might be jumping out here. Oh, here's someone else coming in. I'm just going to like keep talking and I'll act like I have like lots of people helping me here. But basically what we're going to do is I thought I'd show you guys something where I've got the first kind of an inspiration. I mean, I was kind of inspired by Star Wars when it first came out. I was about 14 or so. And so, you know, that was fun to see all that. And then I kind of found this guy. He's an independent animator at the time. He did some work for Disney. And he did a film that's pretty well known in, he got kind of a following in the science fiction, like convention era when they were doing lots of science fiction conventions, is he kind of put his film out there and a lot of people, you know, kind of grasped onto it and he would go to different conventions and show his film, which is kind of interesting. I thought I'd start off also by just showing his first film that he ever did. He came from, he's a native of Hollywood, California, and he went to UCLA, but he wasn't an animation major. He was in mathematics, and he kind of had to satisfy an art requirement. So he took an animation class, and this is what he did, which is kind of funny because when you see this, you're going to be like, uh-oh, what kind of person is this? Because it is pretty dark. It's like the darkest like thing I've ever seen. And it might be, you know, be interesting to see what you think of it. So, and again, this is like the first time ever doing this. So, you know, I'm still like trying to figure it out. And you are too. You're just trying to figure out what am I watching? Why am I giving up my 7 p.m. on a Friday? I worked hard this week and I have to listen to this guy. What's with this? I don't get this. So this film that he did is called Good Grief. And yeah, so here it is. Let me just find it here.
When you were small and young of age, oblivious to a world of rage, still within you lived, dwelled the fright that with evening came the dark of night. A luminous moon would swim a cloud, and quiet sounds became quite loud. Worst by far were the things unseen that provoked the mind to a silent scream. Thank you. dividing line between real and dream is like a razor's edge, so keen. To be dissolved by warm sun rays that broke the spell with break of day. When you discover, to your elation, that the nightmare was all your imagination.
Are you okay?
Nah, that was the stuff of nightmares, but it was cool.
Yeah. So
it was something
but ambitious.
And so this is one called Animato, where he combines animating like photographs and does some live action stuff in there. And he did it all to this song that was pretty popular in the 60s. And nowadays it would be hard to do because, you know, the copyright laws and all that. But somehow he got permission to do it. And so I'm going to show this one. And yeah, so here it is. So this is called Animato. And this will kind of give you an idea of what his animation is like or was like when he started to work on his other thing. So. Done. I mean, this is like no computer animation here, folks. This is back when we had the old good
That's
old
impressive for the day.
Yeah. This was back when we had, you know, 35 millimeters, 16 millimeters, Super 8 films. And to shoot something like that, he actually made his own kind of animation table, which you're looking at right now, which is he's got a disc there in the middle, and he's got some lamps and
So that last one was all done with like photo cutouts or paper cutouts?
Yeah. It's all like just cutouts, and it started off very, kind of stylized, kind of like a fashion show, kind of slowly. But then as he was going into it, he started to like just make it more interesting and more fun. Just, I mean, look at that. It starts off with a bunch of kind of, during that time, those were fashions of the day. And then turning into this whole like science fiction kind of, going to another planet and all that stuff. But he wanted to kind of make kind of like a calling card to show like what he can do. And anyway, I think this is the thing that got the attention of the people at Disney. And so they commissioned him to do a series of shorts, and one of them was called The Collector, and that was from 1978. Because what happened was, you notice those three films, they didn't give, there's no like credits, and so they weren't going to give him any credit for the film. So he did all this work, and Disney was just going to like, it's like they don't even credit
Thanks,
him.
boy.
That's
Yeah.
no
So
shame there, friend.
what he decided to do is he put his credits in the film, and there's the AD, assistant director, Devin Cheringo. I think that's his name. And he's a guy that kind of helped him out. If you actually go further in here, there's a bunch of all this stuff you can see. Or if I can flip through there, so you can see stuff here. And it's just amazing how it's like one guy and a friend just kind of setting this up and doing all this work. Now, the thing about this is you might be wondering, how does that actor sit there and while they're animating all these things around them? Well, the thing is, he's not real. He's actually a they made a life mask, kind of made up this character. Now in this one, I don't know, maybe he is, but I doubt it. I think they put something there and they just kind of made him look like the other guy. But I'll show you in a second what I'm talking about. But yeah, so here's the thing where they're doing this, and all the toys are like marching out, and as they march out, they're kind of show the credits here. So this is one thing he does do a lot of, kind of interesting, kind of Easter eggs he puts in. I guess that's a good way of saying it. And the other thing is, this is the first ever kind of stop motion Mickey Mouse. And I'm not sure if he built this thing or he just adapted a toy, but as you can see, he kind of bounces out like this. And then leaves like that. I think that's pretty cool. So, yeah, so this is the thing. So like here, I don't know, it's just a little bright to see, but he's got this light and he's kind of writing his name, Mike.
Mike.
Yeah, in lights kind of there. It's a little hard to see, but basically that guy in the foreground is a dummy. They made a mannequin. And because
Smart.
they wanted to do a thing where right here you can see it kind of. So that's, obviously that's his hands. That's a real person doing that. But let me just go back a little bit. But that's a dummy that they kind of, and then he just animated the pencil. But you notice that guy is not moving whatsoever. Just the hand is doing the stuff. And then we cut to, a real person doing this, and then all this other stuff happening, getting close-ups of different things, showing this, cutting away to different things. And yeah, it's just amazing all this merchandise, that was. And so yeah, so here's
Mickey Mouse
one.
has talked about everything.
Yeah, so there's the dummy, and we're just kind of putting different hats on them as we zoom away from him, and we put things in the background moving along. So you've seen every single like Mickey Mouse hat there ever was. And then there's all these kind of chess pieces and stuff. Well, yeah, this is awesome. And then going into, yeah, he's just like, yeah, it's like all this stuff you can frame by frame through this stuff and see. And now we go to all the ornaments that, you know, ever were made, I guess. And he's trying to showcase all this stuff. But yeah, all this stuff, it's just all this is stuff, handmade. Sparkle effects are all done with like just taking a black sheet of plastic and poking holes in it, and or painting little, like keeping the things you want clear to animate, you know, and doing all this stuff. And it's just all this crazy stuff going on like that. And now this might be a photograph that they've taken and just started animating things around it. But I mean, look at that. I mean, that is amazing, you know?
Yeah.
It's like you're sitting there going, I mean, especially back in the day when we were like, you know, we're almost, this is 1978. So Star Wars had already come out and we've already seen like the Death Star cleared the planet. And now we're seeing all this kind of crazy, wacky stuff here. Yeah, that was pretty cool. So this is just a short, like kind of a silly educational film. And this is where he actually plays like this other kind of character. He's actually was with the friends of his that kind of came up with this thing, and he was kind of being the bad guy. So he's the bad guy, and that's pretty much all you need to know. It's kind of silly, but I thought you'd like to see it. So,
and now the concluding episode of the mystery movie.
Latitude here. You lose them, we spot them, sweetheart.
Where is Transylvania? I must find Transylvania. Come to 902 Maltman Avenue. Price is no object.
This looks like a job for Captain Latitude. Located somewhere north of the equator.
Yeah. How far north?
I know. It's located somewhere on this line.
But that line goes all the way around the Earth. You tricked me!
Never fear! Longe is here!
Hey, I was here first!
Nonsense! Longitude is everywhere.
Well, you're not staying here.
But I know where Transylvania is.
Ah!
Let me see. East or west? Longitude can find it best. It's somewhere on that line.
But where on that line?
Well, I told you how far east it is. Longitude can't do everything, you know.
Idiots!
I already told him it was somewhere on this line.
But you're wrong. It's on this line.
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 At last, I know. I'm late!
He went through the window!
Thank you.
And that concludes our mystery movie for the evening. But now, a word from the man who makes all of this possible.
Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Wow. That's awful nice they said that. So, yeah. So that was just
Matt and Long's excellent adventure.
Yeah, that's pretty funny, huh? So, but yeah. Anyway, so this these are some of the films that I remember, like, seeing, like, when I went to an actual science fiction convention, because I knew that he was going to be there, and I was like kind of a big fan, and I was in Florida where I lived, and I was like, oh, I could do it. Yeah, I could get there. So I it was in high school, I remember, and I went down with some friends, and so we went there, and man, the day I went there, I had the worst cold. I was just like, it was like bad, but I had to, you know. So anyway, I got to meet him, and I've actually talked to him a few times, and I actually wrote him like just a, like, hey, thanks, you know, like a big fan, you know. But here's this. So I would get this as a reply. So I don't know if you can see this, but let's just tip that over. All right, there. Like, that is how big he writes.
Wow.
You see?
That's
yes. So that was from like 1989. And yeah, so this is a postcard I got for Christmas one year. And yeah, he had taken a picture of these, I guess, and he put it out there. So yeah, so I was pretty amazed when I got this. I was like, oh wow, this is great. And then you know, to see that handwriting, I was like, oh my God, you know, geez. How do you write that tiny, you know? So anyway,
why do you write that tiny?
Yeah, I know, it's pretty wild. So anyway, so now I'm going to show you the actual film that I'm talking about that kind of got me all excited as a kid. And this is called The Wizard of Speed and Time. And this was done in like 1979 and by two guys and in their garage. It did all the work on this, so here it is. Enjoy.
Dum
your wishes in the camera lens. Just watch for the wizard in the robe of green, and I will help you find your dream.
Hey, so
it was really good.
Yeah, that's what I thought too.
I think that one got stuck in your head.
yeah. So yeah, this is one of those things, like people would see this and they'd be like, wow. And again, this came out right when Star Wars was, you know, a couple years earlier. And yeah, when we started seeing this stuff, I was like, whoa, what is that? And then to find out that it was only done by a guy and, you know, his friend in his garage. You know, it was just amazing to see all that. If we go through this, and mainly in the running stuff, I mean, it's just amazing also to see how he keeps the character in that one area. Mm-hmm. And it's stop motion, and it's blurred. So how the heck is that working? Here you can actually see that there's dust on the gate. Like, this is the gate of the film. So all that is just a bunch of crap that was on the inside the camera at the time. And, you know, we can't get rid of that because it was back in the day. They couldn't do that. But all this is just shot from I think it's on his motorcycle. There's a motorcycle that they hooked up a camera to. And then they found this kind of wiggly, if you go down to Venice Beach, you can actually see the first street that's on Venice Beach is called Speedway. And here's just little things like this, of course. You just get a bunch of neighbors to drive really, really slow down a street. And then you run around
and pan out.
Yeah, you just start to slow. Yeah, you're zooming out slightly. And you're just running around like a crazy man around the cars and zipping off like that. And, you know, this is all just sped up. And so here you just put yourself on a little, I'm not sure how they did this. Like, maybe he's like in a little, you know, the car or a truck or something. He's just sitting in the truck and wiggling around and just shooting stop motion like that. And my favorite is when they drop off right here. So he just kind of takes off like this and she's spinning around. And then she's very good at acting in stop motion. And that's probably looking up towards the Hollywood sign. And this, if you go to Sunset, like near Hollywood and Highland, you can actually see this wall. It's still there. And he basically did is just kind of jumped up and they took a picture, jumped up, took another picture, moved it down there, jumped up, and just kept doing that, you know. And then here you can see where he kind of starts to come down, he's like there, then he's there. And all he's doing is just moving his arms back and forth and running up, you know, running a little farther, freezing, running up a little farther, freezing, running up a little farther. And it goes up like that. And he goes all the way, keep going, keep going, keep going, and then until you leave the screen. And so, yeah, so this is all just sped up acting, you know, with the characters and stuff, the actors. That's not really a phone. That's phone is just a phone line that they kind of put on something on off screen. It's not really a real phone. And these are the two guys. One of them is the cinematographer, and the other one's just the guy did the music for the film. And then he just found a bunch of friends to come running towards camera and all that. Let's see if I can go through this. Okay, that's so impressive right there. You just get to find the slowest moving train and you run faster than the train. This was one of, you know, that's just an impressive sight right there. But it's actually just a very slow moving train you know, it's just creeping along, and he's just running as fast as he can. And as you can see, it must be pretty slow because he's going pretty fast. And anyway, so there's that. And then when they finally kind of go through here, still sped up, all this fun stuff cutting back and forth, where he kind of flies over and they're looking at this. The next scene is where he looks back and then he kind of goes into hyperdrive here and kind of goes like that and then comes out. We see more kind of point of view shot. And so you look at this, and you go, well, now how did they do that? Well, it's just a photograph and they've got a thin piece of cell acetate is on top of that. And then he's taken a little like China marker, like a white China marker. And he's kind of very delicately made this kind of blurry looking thing. And he's kind of erased it at the end. And, you know, just kind of showing this kind of like water being thrown on land. And then it's cutting now to the live action. So all this stuff is all just animated on a flat piece of, you know, just a photograph. And then we're cutting to live action, kind of running through the hills here and the blurriness and all that. And then the fun part of just collecting all these signs and showing them come in and going into overdrive here. And this is a real fun one too, because I was like watching this. I'm like, how did he get, like all these things aren't really related, but they are, because if you notice the line there, the horizon line is just cut right in half. And as soon as you get to the next one, it's almost like it's going back and forth. See, you can click between the two. And it's almost like that line is still present. It's a different photograph, but as you zoom towards it, it cuts again. So see, you can see if I flip back and forth, where he's kind of like lined up the background line there, the kind of where the hills are like that, and then just continue it even further into this, into that. So it's like some of the things match and it feels like, you know, the image is completely, you know, wet to dry. And then, you know, but it all kind of syncs up in such a way that it's just it's getting faster and faster and faster, which means it's getting less and less. And he's kind of blurring now as things go by, he's blurring like the stuff. And then you notice little things in here.
Help.
So he's put his name on a ship and then he's put this down here on the France. And that's in the, with the Taj Mahal. And then there's this. And then just doing all this stuff. And then just going to this whole thing. And then we see the joke, the banana, and then flying in. And then going over and landing into the you know, looks like Cinderella's castle. And then all this was shot in his garage, where, if you want to learn more about this, you can go to, he's got an actual feature film called the same thing. It's called The Wizard of Speed and Time. Again, the acting's a little bit, I don't know, not the best, easy. But yeah, but all this stuff is working real well. I mean, he kind of shows this stuff in some of his films you've seen. Here's something that's kind of fun. He's actually labeled some things here, like, this is his brother named Greg. So he has a brother named Greg that he thought he'd put in the film there. And then, you know, he's making it look like they're blinking. And all this stuff is just panning the camera slightly and then putting all those effects in later. And like this little clapboard is used a lot, where he puts a lot of information in here just for fun, you know. And so Lair, if you notice, if you look at the leg of the tripod, it says taxpayer. And if you notice this little guy that's kind of in the background, the little clapboard, he comes over and he represents the IRS, Uncle Sam. Yeah. So he's kind of putting a little subliminal message in there, I guess.
Taking a bite out of the taxpayer.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So he's some little political things, I guess, at the time he was, you know, just wanted to put some little Easter eggs in there so he could enjoy it as well. I think, and so here's a great way to find out. So as this comes in, it says call 213 and he puts his phone number right there to find out who made this film. There it is. But he wanted to do that so, you know, maybe someone would see it and, you know, watch it and go, hey, you know, we like this thing. Can you do more of this kind of stuff? Here's just a something funny. It just says snippety, snippety, chomp, chomp, munchy on there. nothing too bad. This is pretty cool too. So he's put his names in lights. So that's a J, an I, a T, an L, O, and a V. And then he pops in and kind of does that. And so like all that is there is just a spotlight that's kind of going on and off. And in stop motion, it feels like it's got something. And this, it just says on the slate, it says, let's see if we can see it. It says dramatic resolution. I think it says something else. Hark, hark, dramatic resolution. So it runs away to hide. Not to bother anybody again. So in here, I think it says little things. Let's see, I don't think that's anything. But see, it says film by Mike Jittlov there. And he says other things. That's him standing in the middle, animating all the cans while somebody else is kind of moving the stuff on the outer sides of that thing. So yeah, you can watch the feature film of this. And they kind of give you an idea of how they did it by showing this stuff. But they just rented all this stuff. So there you can see it says copyright 1979. And then just before you see that, he kind of turns to do that. So it's a lot of different films, cameras there. Here's another one that's kind of fun. Here's a jab at the freelancer. Versus the unions, catch 22, the rules, the dues. He wasn't really into that or something. I don't know. But anyway, just doing all these different things. Yeah, he might be spelling out something. Who knows? Anyway, yeah, and then that's the kind of the end of the movie. And they all run away and we just kind of pan back and we see all these rippling kind of cans coming down. Like, looks like things are moving like that. So anyway, and there you have it. Kind of just playing around with kind of blurring the camera and all that. And then going into this kind of thing at the end. So yeah, so that's what I saw as a kid that just made me go crazy. So one of the things I was like, oh my gosh, that's amazing. I don't know if I can show you this, but this is basically his, he wrote this, kind of wrote down the lyrics of the song. And then he added all these kind of like, who is it there? You can see kind of like what's happening was what he's doing there. He's got all these timing notes and things.
Yeah.
And yeah, so he's got all these little things, that little notes and things that he's put on there. I'm not sure what all maybe that's footage, but I do know that probably all these things are different scenes that you're seeing on the side there. So it's going through, and then yeah.
His own homemade X sheets.
Yeah, exactly. Almost, yeah. It's kind of like doing that. So anyway. Anyway, I just thought I'd share that with you guys and you know, see if you just inspire you a little bit.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. So anyway, but yeah, so there it is. It's over an hour. Oh no, it's animation hours. I thought it was gonna be less. Oh no. So anyway, well, I hope you enjoyed that, and I might be doing more of these. I don't know.
Yeah, for sure.
So we'll think of something else. And if you guys have any ideas, let me know. You know, write me an email, and maybe we can figure out something else to do. You know, maybe, I don't know. I don't have no idea what if this is going to become like the next thing, or if it's just like, yeah, well, maybe not. You know, who knows? But I really appreciate you guys coming in, especially all the way from Vietnam, right, Nathan?
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. And what time is it now? It's like 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock a.m. Yeah. Okay. All right. So yeah. Thanks for guys for coming in. And I'll have more stuff to show hopefully later on. And you can always check out Animate Educated on YouTube. And I'm always trying to put stuff up there. And if you hear of anything else, let me know. And you know, always there to kind of put stuff up. So well, I hope you enjoyed that. This is our first animation hour, 1 hour or less. This was a live kind of streaming kind of Zoom event. And that's it. So if you enjoyed this and you'd like to see more, you can press that button right there to subscribe to this channel. And if you have ideas for this, let me know in the comments below, or you can look at these two. This is a couple other things you might find interesting. And we'll see you next time on Animate Educated.